am here today to talk a little bit about designing transformative games for impact from a designer's perspective and also from a research perspective. So I'm very excited to join Fina for the third Games for Impact Poland event. This is very exciting. And there are amazing games in the lineup. I've been designing games pretty much my whole life. I started off as a digital game designer. Then I started doing board games, urban games, card games, etc. So, and now VR and other kinds of things. And I also run a game design research lab at an American university called Dartmouth College. And we actually study, do full experimental psychological studies on various games, including the games that we make in-house. And I've always been curious about who we are when we play games. Who do we become when we cross into a virtual or actual magic circle? And can games fundamentally change us or change how we see the world or how we act in the world? So those are the kinds of questions that are driving me. Of course, we're all here because some of us think that games can make the world a better place. Others of us are curious about how that's even possible. And I'm working on a variety of games that are aiming to open up mindsets, think how we think, disrupt stereotypes, and confront biases. And therefore, these are difficult and daunting tasks that are really very difficult for a designer to figure out. How is it possible that we can face these global challenges with games? And how do we know that games are doing what we think they're doing? This is a big question. And so that's what we're working on in my research lab. And I want to share that research with you today. But I also want to point out that games have been researched since the 1990s, when Harvard Dr. Robert Stickgold conducted experiments with Tetris to see how people were learning Tetris and to see if they could guide the dreamer's dreams when people slept by playing the game Tetris before sleep, and do people improve in the game before and after sleep. So the team showed actually that participants who dreamed about playing Tetris actually reinforced their learning and improved in the game. So there have been thousands of studies since then involving games, psychology, health, neuroscience. And as from a design perspective, these studies are really valuable because they give us actual metrics or goals to understand what games are doing and to better understand how, when we're designing, we can aim for those outcomes. So in my talk today, I want to give several assertions, three assertions, in fact, that what you can take to heart from a design perspective to see how you might actually consider new aspects of how you are creating your games. One is idea about framing, and it's a psychological framing related to gender and gender reveals. Now, what do I mean by that? Framing is how we set up an experience. In psychology, it's a very well studied area about how framing a situation or even a consumer experience shapes how we act in that situation as customers, learners, and game players. One of my students studied this board game called Blockus, which is kind of like Tetris, but but in plastic. And the game is advertised as promoting spatial reasoning and helping with strategy and logic. So it was a really interesting game to study. But so in my students' study of over 100 undergraduate students, the student found that there is this idea of stereotype threat running rampant throughout the gameplay experience. First, she introduced the game as just play a game. She had randomly assigned male and female players play the game. And as you see on the right, that chart, it's a little bit cut off, but that chart is the control condition about how the players actually performed on a spatial reasoning test later in after playing. So both men and women had about the same spatial reasoning scores on standardized tests, rotation and shape rotation and things like that. Well, it's very interesting because the other categories, the experimental categories, were when she introduced the game as a strategic game or as a spatial game. Just framing the game very differently completely changed the test outcomes for the male and female participants. And if you see there, men tended to fare better in strategy framing and even better in spatial framing. And women's test scores went down. Same game, same test. So in same conditions. So you see, there is a very tricky and dangerous thing that we can do when we are framing games. We have to make sure we do it positively for the players. We also tested when you should reveal a character's gender, for example. And here we're looking at male and female gender. We're not studying non-binary, but of course that would be the next thing to include in these kinds of studies. So we have this board game called Monarch, and you play as the queen. And the queen is going to pass on her crown to one of her four daughters. And it's a set collection strategy game, a light strategy game for two to four players. Well, really interesting stuff happens when you take this to an all-male school. Now, this is not the all-male school. These are players at a convention, but it is quite interesting. We took it to United States male boarding schools, high schools. So we were looking at 14, 15-year-old students, male students. And we separated the groups into the conditions into an early reveal and a late reveal. So in the first condition, we told students, you are playing as sisters. Gave them the information right up front. And then the second one, the second condition, we had players play and they were at about round, like 13 moves in, and they realized that they were sisters. So two different kinds of framing. Now, as a designer, I'm watching these two groups. And the one group is quite reluctant to one group is quite reluctant to engage, you know, oh wow, we're playing as sisters, but eventually they got into it. Another group was like playing and fantasizing about their castles and everything, and then they realized they're sisters and boom. And I thought, gosh, you know, the early reveal, at least they kind of grew into it. And then I thought, oh wow, they're playing. This other group is playing the game, and as soon as they find out they're playing as sisters, wow, they hate this game. And that's not exactly true. My impressions as a designer observing the players' reactions were actually not what the players revealed in the study that we conducted. And when players were actually doing their surveys, paperwork, etc., the early reveal here in the chart is blue. And their evaluations on whether the game was great, what they thought about the game, whether, and then in the lower chart, the experience taking piece, did they actually, you know, become part of being? Did they take on the persona of the character? It seems that the delayed reveal allowed the players to do that better than the early kind of understanding who you are. So sometimes there's this like idea of stealth identity that we can actually get people to empathize with people who are unlike themselves, possibly by not necessarily revealing all of their details right away. And then players could come into this. There's been a lot of studies about this in narrative and in writing as well, in storytelling. So this is just an example of how you can think about stepping into the role. Here is an interesting little side. People are saying, I found it easy to step into my role. A little ambiguity might go a long way in helping players identify. And one more piece on the gender piece here, and that is the aha moment. So we did a study in VR where we had male science students at a university play Escape the Room game in VR, but they played it three quarters of the way through. They see themselves in the mirror and they're a woman. And we ended up writing a paper on this aha moment, like suddenly understanding that you aren't the character you think you are. Now, maybe some of you have seen that in the game Portal or also Metroid. There's a kind of a history of this kind of gender reveal in the game. But in fact, in that study, we found that the participants who realized that they were a woman showed fewer biases against female scientists in the data collection after the material. So really interesting stuff about how you set up a game, how you frame a game. It can affect gender perceptions, and if it affects gender perceptions, it probably affects other kinds of social categories and public categories that you might want to take into consideration as a designer. Assertion two, games can encourage people to intervene, such as in preventing sexual assault. This is, I'm going to show you two games, and we've studied these at university levels as well. These are games that were intended to help university students if they see a problem in terms of someone is maybe being about to be victimized in a situation, to be a bystander and intervene, and not necessarily violently. In fact, the best kinds of intervention strategies are sometimes to distract someone or to say, oh, I was looking for you, or some other kinds of intervention. We're not talking about encouraging violence or anything. There's a lot of literature on bystander intervention and how you can encourage people to take a stand and stand up for someone else. So we made games that look nothing like, you know, situations of, you know, like parties or sexual assault situations. Like we made a trivia game, in fact. And you play, it's a team-based trivia game. You play with people in the same room. And in fact, I'm not sure if the video will show here. Yeah, it is. I think it is going. So you play in these small groups, and there are questions about football and Harry Potter and movies and all kinds of things. But in the content, occasionally there are questions that relate to women's rights, to sexual assault conduct, for example, situations involving a movie star or something like that. So there are these situations that are mixed in. And even a few of those items mixed in actually does seem to get people thinking in pretty interesting ways. When we measured this after gameplay using the bystander efficacy tests, which are developed from the social sciences, we did a pilot study with 250 American students in a university in New England, and found that players who played this game in their freshman orientation had significantly increased bystander intervention scores. So that's a measure of how comfortable they would be intervening in a situation, even a month after playing the game. So games don't always look like the kind of topic that you're dealing with. You might be doing something about, for example, hunger, but that doesn't necessarily mean the story has to be about hunger, is what I'm trying to get you to think about here. Is like sometimes the game itself doesn't necessarily have to be on topic in order to make a difference. And that's one of the things we specialize in. How can we come at some of these problems from left field and really shift the psychological part, not necessarily the storytelling part of people's experience. The second game we made in this sexual assault prevention project was called Ship Happens, and it's an animated comic and a kind of comic game where a story is that two students go on a spring break trip, but they're in outer space. And they end up going to virtual sporting events and things like that. But inside this intergalactic adventure, for example, they still go to a local convenience grocery store and run into someone who has a relationship violence. They have some kind of difficult situations with some of the creatures, some aliens they encounter, and so. That these kinds of themes coming out in the game kind of get around something that's a little too close to home or a little too realistic. If we had set this at an American fraternity university party, A lot of the students might just say, oh, I know what they're going to tell us. They're going to try to tell us that this is all about, you know, parties and, you know, dangers at parties. And there's a phenomenon called psychological reactance, where we just were like, nope, nope, I'm not dealing with that. And how do you get around psychological reactance? Well, we have to be creative about that. And it's a real thing. When we studied as a package these two games together in a four-week interval, so it was a longitudinal study. The players played the games, and then there was a gap of over a month, and we got the same people back together to revisit with the students and measure any kind of lingering effects of what the intervention may or may not have done. We found that players were more comfortable being asked to intervene, that they had a higher estimation of their own abilities to challenge situations. And a month may not feel very long, but in fact, a month gap in a game intervention and looking at a game's impact, these kinds of longitudinal studies are actually not done very often. So it's very valuable information to see how you can see a game's effect over time, even if it's not being continually played. And on this screen, it's measuring bystander attitudes, which the last screen was efficacy composite, which is how competent they feel to intervene. And this one is about their attitudes, about being interested in intervening, being wanting to help others. So the takeaways for this are that unusual looking games can actually deal with your issue. Mixing on-topic information with off-topic information, something we call intermixing, is very important in the way that you can get around these notions of psychological reactance towards getting people open-minded about your issue at hand. Okay, the last assertion I want to make is very timely worldwide with Black Lives Matter. We have done research about games shifting prejudices. And for me, this is very important work because it shows you what is really possible. And this is just one small study. Imagine if we had 20 or 30 of these kinds of studies, what would happen if we were all making games trying to fight prejudices, stereotypes, racism, homophobia, all of the things that that are challenging social issues of our time. So we really were looking at unconscious biases, not people's blatant biases, but thinking about unconscious biases. And this game started off as a game to encourage to get over biases about women in science. The first version of the game was quite simple, and it developed into this kind of entertaining party game. It's a card game. It's called Buffalo, and it's available all over. You draw two cards, such as this, and you're in a group, and the first person to get the answer gets the cards as points. It's a very simple game. So pre-1900s feminists, Mary Shelley. So if we were playing in a group, which I wish we were, because I would like to see you. We would be playing this game and trying to figure out a Muslim philosopher. Oh my gosh, you know, so getting all of our answers together. Nerdy athletes. Actually, Shaquille O'Neal has a PhD. I'd call him nerdy in that way because it's, you know, if you have a PhD, I do. So thinking about it, this game puts together these random combinations, but the random combinations can actually, here's the cards I was, the random combinations, pre-1900s feminist, thinking about the Muslim philosopher or nerdy athlete, these combinations, you know, are very normal for, they can be very normal, like male wizard, you could say Harry Potter, everybody knows that, but really when you have combinations that are more surprising, those combinations themselves actually can challenge how we think about categorization in the first place. So when we studied this game, the control condition was doing the test before playing the game, and then we had the game condition, which was playing this game called Buffalo. We used two different psychological tests called social identity complexity and universal orientation scale. These are games that measure prejudice, racism, and things like this. Social identity complexity is quite interesting because it's kind of how we imagine the world. So it's the degree of perceived overlap of someone's own social group. So Ruckus and Brewer report that membership in many different groups, having multiple social identities, can lead to greater social identity complexity, which kind of makes one more open in terms of a global identity. So you're really trying to get to more complex social identity in the way that we're thinking about design. This is interesting for designers because sometimes we want to teach people about the injustices of discrimination, which is well and good. But researchers also show that counter-stereotypical messages, actually intentionally counter-stereotypical messages, are really the way to go when we're thinking about fighting these ideas and trying to foster a way around bias. So there's a lot of psychological barriers when it comes to bias. There's the stereotypes and prejudice. This is all called the bias blind spot. And it is very easy for each individual person to not even recognize where their biases are. So can games help with that? I think they can. And it's a place for all of us to explore, I think, as we're creating issues that matter, games about issues that matter to us. Okay, my one final assertion is, well, it's not really an assertion. It's a word of caution. I've shown you a lot of, you know, success stories from my research lab, and we can read a lot of success stories even and hear a lot about them at this conference. But it's also good to realize when we fail. And it's important to know because sometimes we could be doing harm instead of good. And there have been studies about some games for change. When they're actually brought into a research setting, some games can actually have an inverse or kind of the wrong kind of impact. And that's why this studying this stuff is important for designers, because sometimes what we think we're doing isn't necessarily the end goal. And this study by Gina Russo, she studied this game called Spent, which is a great little game about putting yourself in someone's shoes as they have very little money. And it's to show how close someone can get to being homeless. But when the game was studied, because, and there are, the reason for this is still in question. It's what we speculate, Gina speculates, and I tend to agree, that there was no effect on positive feelings towards the poor. And the game had a negative effect on attitude among certain participants, including some people who are sympathetic to the poor to begin with. The idea is that because games foster the sense of agency, like I can do this, I can change, right? Then there was this idea of assigning that agency to someone who is in that situation. So it can get a sense that poverty is a personally controllable and therefore controllable phenomenon, therefore empathy can become reduced. And that's something that we would, if we're making a game to combat poverty, the last thing we would want to do is make players less empathetic to the situation. So being careful is part of, I think, what we're charged to do to make sure that our games are doing the right thing and having the right message. So in my short time with you tonight, I've made these assertions, and I hope I provided some provocative data to support what I've called evidence-based design. And this is a trend that can help us really understand what we're doing with our games. All of these projects, if there's research papers associated with them, they're at my website, tiltfactor.org. That's the lab's website. And you can download the papers there and read more about the specific data points. And I guess to close, as I start to wrap up, I want to just kind of take a big picture moment to celebrate games, because game scholar Janet Murray notes that games give us a chance to enact our most basic relationship with the world. Our desire to prevail over adversity, to survive our inevitable defeats, to shape our environment, master complexity, and to make our lives fit together like the pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. Games are these art forms of enactment, and they provide spaces for systems of being and thinking to happen. And since their creation, all games, they've occupied a human space far more important than the pastimes for which they're often mistaken. Games as a broad category of art have been around for at least 8,000 years, if not longer, we have evidence, longer than written language. And they connect us to an ancient social practice of humanity. And we can't forget this as we shape design approaches to game that excel at positive social impact. So that ends the part of my talk. I'd like to have a Q&A. Hopefully we can do that. Dziękuję bardzo for all my friends in Poland. And I'm very happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you for your wonderful speech, Mary. As you said, we have time, so I would like to ask a question directly from one of our viewers. Limiting choice in games can make communicating pre-authored narratives much easier and clearer, but at the same time, it limits players' ability to honestly contribute to the theme. How can we work with the nature of agency and player choice to communicate themes?
Can you just say the first part again? This is an interesting question. I don't want to miss it.
Okay. Limiting choice in games can make communicating pre-authored, narratives much easier and clearer, but at the same time, it limits players' ability to honestly contribute to the theme. How can we work with the nature of agency and player choice to communicate themes?
That's an interesting question. I mean, part of what makes a game is abstracting reality into discrete elements, right? Otherwise, we are making an open world in which we have the same choices we have now. And of course, we don't have infinite choices as people. Oh, if we only had them. So I think, I mean, that's the beauty. And in some ways, you know, when I think about game design, I tend to think of trying to create what's the haiku of this situation. What's a distilled, beautiful and meaningful abstraction, a simplification that actually communicates meaning. Agency is, I think, games are about agency. They are art forms of agency. They are verbs, but limitations are also where we actually find meaning. So I think we just have to, if you're thinking about narrative games where you have like multiple, you know, directions, you know, like choose A, B, or C, you know, I'm thinking that maybe the choices may not be so obvious. Maybe your storytelling has to get a little bit off of left field. And so when we tell stories, the story can happen. I mean, this is a big question.
I've got more, how to put it, straightforward question. Games have a positive impact.
That's a big
one. I know. Yeah, it's... anyway, games have a positive impact on individuals and small communities, but would you really say games improved humanity? What would be the top examples or hopes?
Well, I mean, certainly we could talk about, you know, obvious examples like the Olympics or national identity and big sporting events. We would think about those kinds of things as games. We have, I think that there's a huge... Sometimes there are more people playing in online games. I mean, when Candy Crush came out, there are more people playing Candy Crush than there were like in several countries, right? You have, so it's another kind of connecting. Whether we agree on the content and the value of some of the kinds of things we're doing, that the act of sharing a global or a national or a, you know, distributed kind of phenomenon is a connecting experience, just to know that it's that your experience is going across the world. Games connect us to a lot of things. I mean, in the pandemic, game sales are up tremendously, and it's partly because games are connect. Games are one of the main ways friends are connecting across the world. So, regardless of the activities in certain games, there is this kind of connecting factor that is really meaningful. And there's also other kinds of things. You know, there's plenty of studies about positive effects neurologically speaking on hand-eye coordination and being good at kind of multitasking. There's a lot of studies about World of Warcraft players, you know, being hired by the stock exchange to be better at financial management because they're used to managing so many resources at once. So there are these kind of anecdotal things too that games are really helpful about problem solving. But I mean, they can always improve, you know, and part of the interest from designers is always making a better design. You know, what is a better solution? So so I think in that sense, we'll see even more possibilities for impact as people even make new game models that we can't even imagine right now.
Speaking about World of Warcraft, do you think we should challenge AAA games, which keep on repeating stereotypes? How should we do it?
I do think we should. I think the game industry has been a very conservative, risk-averse game industry. The best challenge, I think, are the independent game designers, the kind of games that are actually in the Games for Impact exhibition right now and your collection of games. Some of these games, AAA developers play a lot of independent game makers' games to get ideas. It's terrible. I mean, but it's good if you get their ideas to be more pro-social, right? And I think the industry is slowly changing. Some of the people are getting older. I've noticed a big difference in AAA companies when the average age gets to be parenting age, and people start having kids at home, and they're like, oh, I don't know, maybe we should not make that scene in this game. Maybe we should. So I think as people actually see the impact in their own families and communities, they kind of shift some of this. That's not to say that we have violent video games, we have violent films and everything else, but I'm just looking for more diverse games and games with a lot of possibility. I think in the next 5 to 10 years, we will see AAA companies hiring very woke, very very conscientious young people who want change. And there, you all are going to be being hired the next generation in these companies, and you can push. So I think the best push is kind of from within.
Well, I'm rooting for it. And another question from our viewer: is game playing better in engaging people with complex issues than other medias, other meds?
Well, we've done some, it's a good question. We've done some studies about, for example, reading versus gameplay, this kind of thing. It's hard to measure how, you know, what's better. Certainly games help you have to kind of balance what you're doing and what you're thinking about and your possible options. And that's different. I would just say maybe it's different, not better. Certain things lend themselves more to games. So for example, complex systems, obviously, understanding complex systems, you certainly, if you read a short story about a complex system and then you play SimCity, you're gonna, SimCity actually helps you, or you know, any kind of large scale game, you're gonna be able to see all of these components in a very different way, in a very hands-on way. So I do think games are wonderful at modeling complexity. But they also do abstract it, right? So they do abstract complexity. And as the designer, you have so much responsibility. What things to leave in and what things to leave out? And sometimes we've left the wrong things out.
The wrong things out?
For example, like I'll take The Sims. So it's very nice. It's fun to play. In later Sims you could have same-sex marriages, for example, which was really great. Same-sex partners, yeah. But maybe they've left out things like, you know, bias. What if one character is biased against another character? What if one character one family moves next door and they're immigrants? You know, they've left out some difficult stories. So that's what I mean. When some of our global challenges, it'd be interesting to be bringing them into more to more of our play experiences so we can understand them better.
Another question from a viewer who obviously didn't watch us the first day of Games for Impact. How can professionals from other sectors take part in the game design process? What are the benefits and challenges of cross-sector cooperation?
Well, certainly it depends on the sectors, right? I don't know if we have the same description in the United States, but certainly universities and industry partners, for example, would be very good together because universities can do research like this and do research studies and come up with novel ways of understanding something. Right now, if you're, especially AAA titles, but right now, if you're a AAA designer and you're looking at how people go through your level, you're not measuring how the game might be making you more biased or more, you know, or so some of these social and psychological factors would be very interesting, I think, for industry people to understand working with a university. And university people would find very interesting how much game designers have to think about audiences and players and making things so easy and so understandable. And getting the right challenge. We all have things to learn from each other. And nonprofit organizations as well, partnering with university research teams and game companies. I don't know if game companies would have that much time for them, but small independent ones might.
Nicely said. And moving on, the Game Awards are almost there. If found, Kentucky Road Zero TV Edition, Spiritfarer, Tell Me Why, and Through the Darkest of Times were nominated in Games for Impact category. Who are you rooting for and why?
Well, Kentucky Road Zero is a favorite at my laboratory and everyone's...
It's a blast, yeah.
So it's a favorite. It's quite rich. So I think so far, I think that one would win just because of the I know the fan base is everyone I work with. So that makes it very interesting to me to see that even people are streaming playing it a lot. It's reaching a lot of people, and that is part of how we measure impact.
A rather cliche question. What's your take on the relationship between violent video games and physical aggression? And that's a good question because I know for a fact you wanted to talk about it more during your presentation.
Yes, well, I'm asked this question pretty much on a weekly basis. But that's okay because it is an interesting question. We have a lot. Especially in the United States, we have a lot of violent rhetoric happening. We have a lot of people interested in thinking about violence. And when we see games having violence, we have to kind of ask the question: oh wow, is this making me a more horrible person? There's some issues about that. There have been studies that I don't really study games in violence. I try to make games that do what I want them to do, pro-social things. I try to make positive games. But if I'm asserting that games can do positive things, then perhaps the unspoken assertion is that games might be able to do negative things too. A colleague of mine at Dartmouth College did a very, very large study. It's like a meta study of 24 different studies that involved over 17,000 people. And the participants, they were like between 3 month smaller studies and even 4 year longitudinal studies. And they were various nationalities, various ethnicities with ages from 9 to 19 years of age. And what was very interesting about that, that set of studies is that there is this kind of link between risk-taking behavior and violent tendencies with certain people who are already prone to that kind of behavior. I encourage you to read, the researcher's name is Jay Hull, H-U-L-L. And it's great to have one study that's a big collection of other studies because it's like a 35, he has this like very long paper, like 35 pages of paper.
I promise I will.
And it's a very... It's really good. You know, I don't always come to the same conclusion. There was a lot of controversy also with some of the violence in video games researchers not having some of them some of the studies were proven to be not well conducted. So some of the literature that's published is questioned, which is interesting. That means that maybe there's less evidence about violence in video games than we might have thought.
Good
I
to
think
hear.
it's very also, but my impression is very difficult to say games are over here and the rest of pop culture is over here, right? We're on YouTube. We're watching this films, and all of these things around us do portray violence. So to separate our experience in games as somehow a cause of something that is all over society is very tricky to do. So it's something I tend not to make that easy blame on
Yeah,
video games,
my point
and
exactly. They're
rather urge
like
us to.
separate beings. Yeah,
Yes, that's
sorry.
yes.
Yeah.
And in fact, most people are playing games and have a movie on at the same time. You know, there's a lot of right. So how do we separate one experience over the other? It's you can do it in a research setting, but real life is messy.
And sometimes they play like Resident Evil and watch Resident Evil at, the same time. And how can we
Right.
separate those two
But then
experiences?
they have Animal Crossing. And it's like, oh. So yeah,
Okay, this
exactly.
one's rather straightforward. Where can I find Shit Happens? Looks like a good benchmark for my project, but can't find it in Google.
Oh, it's at tiltfactor.org. Tiltfactor.org has it. We didn't publish it publicly. We actually just used it for our research study, just to see if it would happen. But it actually should be released because it's done. We just didn't get to it yet. But please read more about it and see the papers on it at tiltfactor.org.
Much obliged. And another question. You're a founder of Game Research Develop, a laboratory that specializes in influential play. I was wondering, did you discover how video games can get us into positive mental states?
Interesting. There are a couple people who study that. I have not studied positive mental states, but or like happiness. There are really interesting research studies on happiness, and I think that there are games that probably would do that. I know in anecdotally, not research-wise, but anecdotally, a lot of people I know would be like, "I just go home and I play Flower by that game company," or I play or Journey, you know. To just like, just zone out. And happy for one person is not happy for another. So you have to, I think it's a complex question about what makes someone happy. You know, it's that kind of constant it's that constant phenomenon. Some people are like, want to come home from work and I want to blow things up. And that makes me happy. And some
Yeah,
people are
it's so
like, I
true.
want to just watch these rainbows or watch cat videos on the internet. You know, we I think more and more I think the most important thing right now for me in thinking about games is thinking about how games are kind of a fluid entity bleeding into other kinds of experiences. And so I'm thinking of Twitch. You know, we're playing, but we're watching. Sometimes we're chatting, but we're playing. Sometimes I'm playing with them. Sometimes I'm watching somebody play. So this kind of a constant dance about what games are really serving as a centerpiece for social interaction.
Sorry, that was like a really inspiring answer. I was, I lost my thoughts. Anyway, the revenue of the Polish game development industry ex exceeds 500 million euros, with game export alone generating nearly 96% of that sum. We create games for the global market. But whether it is possible to talk about important social issues that way, shouldn't video games be more tied to local concerns and local ways of making?
Oh, that's a great question. That's a really good question. I as a as an example of that, That was something when I at one time I lived in Taiwan and I worked with a lot of computer scientists in Taiwan, and everyone then at that time played Japanese games, games from Japan. And I said, why don't you have games about Taiwan? And everyone's like, no one would care about Taiwan. That's changed. Now I think there's more ideas about, yeah, we can have our voice. We can have a cultural identity, for example. We can have a local identity and have others be interested in it. And I want to point out this game by Red Candle Games called Detention. And it's made in 2017. And it's this really great game about the Taiwanese period of martial law, in which students were in a banned book club and various bad things happened. But there are spiritual aspects to the game that have to do with local culture. As a viewer from different places, you might not understand all of those references, but ultimately it's a very moving game that has, it's very tied to the local, but anything that's very, if it's done well, can be a universal expression. So I think that maybe get more specific and it will be more interesting to others.
Speaking about tension, my producer just told me that we're out of time. So, thank you for your
Oh,
wonderful speech. It was a pleasure. My guest
thank
was
you.
Mary Flanagan. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for Twitch. Bye bye. Bye bye, everybody.